Bias, it's everywhere. It can be subtle or overt. It's the conscious or unconscious ways that researchers themselves can insert problems into science. It's also the topic of this module in experimental design. Biases can come into play from start to finish in research. The way a study is designed can be biased. So can the ways in which data are measured. Bias can come into play when making decisions about analysis, interpretation, and even reporting. Some of these are difficult to fix. Researchers have to be involved, for instance, in study design. But in other aspects, one of the most powerful tools that scientists can bring to bear is blinding. Let's start with a completely unblinded trial and work backwards in order to understand how this all works. Let's say that we're interested in how a new medication treats pain. If we give the medication to half the participants and nothing to the other, then it's clear to the subjects which group they're in. Those patients who are getting the drug may experience a benefit. Some patients know they're being treated and others know they're not. There's no blinding at all. This is why we use placebos. When we do, participants are much less likely to know whether they're in the study group or the control group. A placebo-controlled trial is single-blinded because the study subjects themselves have no clue as to what group they're in. Their biases can't come into play because they don't know what intervention they've received. Sometimes it's hard to blind patients. Changes in lifestyle, for instance, can't be replicated in a placebo easily, for instance. In those cases, researchers have to be inventive. Perhaps they can create sham interventions. Surgeons, for instance, sometimes argue that you can't create placebo surgeries, but you might be surprised to find out that there have been a number of studies involving sham or fake surgery so that patients are blinded to interventions they've been given. Even if we manage to blind participants, though, we can still have problems. If researchers know which group participants are in, they can introduce their own biases into the work. If they know which patients are getting a medication and which are getting a placebo, they could treat them differently. Maybe they will be nicer to those receiving the medication. Maybe that will make them report outcomes differently. Maybe they will administer the scales, which are used to measure the main outcome of interest, in a different way depending upon what group the participants are in. Lots of measurements can be subjective, remember, and that opens the door to bias. When researchers try to analyze their results, biases can also come into play if they know which group is which beforehand. They may see preliminary data, which changes how they might like to do the analyses later on. If we blind researchers as to which participants are getting the intervention and which are getting the control, then they can't bias the results in a non-random fashion. They won't know whom to coddle. They won't be tempted to measure results any differently for some patients than for others. When researchers don't know which patients are in which group, they are also blinded. Such experiments are considered double-blinded because neither the participants nor the researchers are aware of how subjects have been randomized. While this concept has been used widely in human subjects research for some time, it has been slower to be adopted into basic science work, especially with animals. Some researchers believe that animals and reagents are inherently unaware of what's happening to them with respect to a trial, so no blinding is necessary. That's just not true. Animals react to stimuli, and we need to consider blinding for many animal studies as well. More importantly, researchers still need to be blinded themselves. They're still biased. They want their work to succeed for any number of reasons, and if they know which animals or even cell lines are intervention or control, they can still bring their biases into play. Sometimes unblinding occurs because of mistakes or issues that arise. That's unfortunate, but it's not the death knell for research. Sometimes you can bring in new people to make measurements or new people to perform analyses. And if you can't, you can still do your best to make sure that your own biases are accounted for in your work. Most importantly, you must acknowledge what occurred in your reports so that others can make appropriate changes and judge your results appropriately. Scientists of all stripes should be blinded to their experiments as much as possible, even those that never work with human beings. It's one of the best and one of the most powerful ways to make sure your biases don't creep into your work. This training module is part of a series funded by the National Institutes of Health.